time for sparkle spotlight. Time for sparkle spotlight. Time for sparkle spotlight.
What an introduction.
I know. You know, we had to take a few takes, but they got it. At the end, Peyton and Morgan, winners, TV, you know, debut, social spotlight. They needed to intro it for me. So
if you've been living in a cave, those Gene Winter's beloved, adorable twin daughters, and Peyton and Morgan.
Yes.
How about Peyton with those glasses? She
so
just
cute.
Loves those glasses.
Absolutely adorable. They did have a puppet show going on down here when you were upstairs prepping for the show. We had a giraffe, we had a Cabbage Patch doll, I think we had a bear. I'm going to forget it, and they're going to be mad because they're probably watching right now. And they were under the desk, and they had their the animals up, and it was really, really cute. So,
don't you agree that the best thing in the world for Gene was having those baby girls to bring out the feminine side in him?
100%. I absolutely couldn't agree more.
I say
more.
That all. Get away from the insanity
Perfect.
Of this male sports-dominated lifestyle.
Get your nails done with them. Go
get
shopping.
Get it off your mind. Absolutely. Play with those little toys and that.
The Barbies and whatnot. It was funny because, you know, Chuckoletti has all kinds of props over here for his show. So they found a pirate wig. They found a rubber chicken that made noise. I mean, they were like having a ball down here, so it was awesome. So we have a couple more cute little things during social spotlight.
The funny thing is, now that they've seen all those Galetti props from Chuck's Last Call, they're going to want to ask Daddy, get me one of those.
I
That'll
know.
Cost him more cash, too.
We'll just send them home. Chuck won't care. He probably won't even miss them, so we'll just start taking one at a
oh,
time.
Oh, he'll miss them. He'll miss them.
Yeah, the pirate wig he uses all the time,
oh,
I'm sure.
Oh, he's got them all logged over there.
Oh,
all the rubber chicken and the wigs and all of it.
Well, we do have a couple more things from the now famous Peyton and Morgan coming up here on Social Spotlight, but first we did post two questions today. First was what stood out in last night's Cavs game, and do you have a problem with Winky tutoring Whedon? So we wanted to throw that out there.
Okay.
So we'll first start with the Cavs. Last night, obviously they lose. Doug Brown is up first, says, the terrible officiating stood out for me, seems glaringly biased sometimes.
Well, what do you think that the officials get together or they're on their cell phones and they're saying, let's always nail the Cavs. Let's always make bad calls against
the
Cavs. And I mean, that is absolutely ludicrous and stupid to have that kind of mentality. And indeed, you should be intelligent enough to realize that NBA officiating is a joke. It always has been a joke. It's the worst it's ever been. And I've been covering the NBA for decades. Despite what David Stern would like to think, he got caught with his pants down with the Donaghy scandal. And it hasn't gotten any better. It's horrible. It dwarfs in comparison to the NFL, and that dwarfs in comparison to the Major League umpires.
John Schrader says what stood out last night for the Cavs is how they lost that game when they were up 20-plus points and lost to the Knicks without Melo. Ugh, very disappointed, he says. And Jeff Klein, Sparenga, says, what stood out to him was how much that the Cavs need a scoring small forward.
Yes, yes. And if Waiters, if he fulfills potential as a two, although I had a very interesting call yesterday or Sunday night from a guy who said that we need at the two guard, we need a guy with some height. And I theoretically agree with that, Ashley. 6'5", 6'6", height that can shoot from the outside and still penetrate where he can get a shot off or maybe get a rebound if he's defending another two that takes him to the hoop. I'd preferably like that. Waiters has proven he can play the point, but it's still very, the Cavs are so young, and we do need more pieces. Everybody knows that.
Kyle Vertok says, Kyrie has his usual 20-plus points, but the real reason the Cavs were up by so many at one point was because of Spates, in his opinion.
Oh, yeah.
Unfortunately, I hate to say it, but I blame last night's loss on Coach Scott.
Well, it's easy to blame Coach Scott, and he's taking a lot of heat this year. I just challenge you, who would you rather have as the coach of an undermanned team with developing young players? I mean, who's better qualified? Who would you rather have? I just can't see it. There hasn't been a coach in football or basketball or a major league manager that has not been second-guessed by loudmouths like myself or by fans. But I challenge you, who are you going to get with an undermanned, because we still need pieces, an undermanned, very young, developing team that's better than Scott?
Daniel Brennis, as far as the Cavs go, this loss proves that not only do they lack a substantial talent in some spots, but they also lacked the killer instinct when they need it most. Another very painful loss and a lost season of opportunities for this team.
Well, I agree with that. That comes with maturity. It comes with, again, the talent of the players. You've got to have, we need more. We just need more. We don't have nearly enough to be even considered as a playoff team, yeah, let alone an NBA championship team. That comes with maturity and experience in the NBA, too.
Lastly, for this...
And by the way, Scott was part of championship teams with the LA Lakers. His demeanor on the sideline may not appear so, but this guy's a gamer and an intense competitor that has several rings. I mean, come on.
Yeah, people don't see him right in the locker room and what he's saying to them and motivating them. So Keith Moore says, disheartening that Coach Byron Scott got outcoached on the last play with 6 seconds. He should have anticipated the Knicks putting Chandler on Kyrie and should have inbounded to someone other than him.
Yeah, and Spates not being in there, too.
Okay, well, we are talking Browns, and we're talking quarterbacks, of course, right? Brandon Whedon, getting a little tutoring from kind of looks like almost the same type of person that he is, right? Almost. And we had a lot of comments on this, a lot of negative comments on this, I do have to say.
Okay.
I'm not sure if you thought that would be
I'm
or not.
I'm anxious to hear them.
Kyle Vertok says, to me, it can only help Whedon improve his game. He has no problem with it. Jarrett Barlidge says, why bother with Winky when Kozar is right there? He would be a much better tutor, he thinks.
Bernie, from all indication, doesn't do that. He has no desire to do that. He's not being employed to do that. So, I agree.
But wouldn't he do it if he wanted to do it?
He doesn't want to do it. So
he would, I'm sure, be out there way more willing to help if he was into that. Richie Stanton said makes about as much sense as Ken Dorsey being a mentor.
That's a good one. Ken Dorsey out of Miami.
Throwing stuff out here, all kinds
that's
of names,
good.
You know.
Ken Dorsey.
Ricky Brogan says, no, Winky didn't make it in the NFL. Why take advice from him?
That's what I don't think there's any harm in it. I said that at the beginning of the show. It can't hurt. I mean, but I said that at the beginning of the show. I mean, even though they both played baseball, even though they were great in college, Winky never cut it in the pros.
Rob Garcia says, the Browns fan in me wants Whedon to be successful, but common sense tells Winky probably isn't the right guy to go for advice unless he's advising him on what not to do.
That's good,
you
too.
You know, there are some nice, clever ones we had to throw in there.
That's good, too.
People do not like him, apparently.
Poor Chris Winky.
Joe Monaco says, Whedon won't be a starting quarterback when the season starts, so he can do whatever he wants anyway.
Ooh, who will be then? I don't think it's McCoy.
Yeah, he did not say who, so he's just saying it will not be
financially,
Whedon.
I don't see the Browns keeping McCoy. Maybe I'm wrong, but
maybe someone will just, you know, fall into place. Charles Amorino says, Winky was an older QB that failed in the NFL. Can't think of anyone better to mentor our version. Before they drafted him, I said, Whedon is the next Winky. Unreal.
Ooh,
exact same
that's harsh.
Thinking that it's him.
Winky didn't throw the ball well, though. Whedon throws a much better ball than Winky in defense of Brandon Whedon. Winky was not a... He wasn't a strong-arm quarterback, even with the heyday at Florida State.
Tim Uglow says, why would any football staff let Winky within a mile of their starting quarterback?
He's well-intentioned.
He is right now,
I mean, the poor guy's taking
a beating.
Nice.
Well, Judith Farr says he did coach Cam Newton in his rookie year at his academy in Florida. He also was an older rookie after a baseball career, just like Whedon. Perhaps he has the perspective to help Whedon that no one else does, because she's the same, you know, if they're kind of the same, maybe he looks up to someone like that and can rationalize with him better. I don't know.
I did not know that about Newton. Is that right, Gene?
Yes.
I did not know that.
There you go.
Newton was tutored by Winky. So, hey.
We have a positive one.
Although, although you know, Newton has a little more God-given talent than Winky or Whedon. So, you know, I think that has to be factored in.
Now, Keith Moore says, those who cannot do, teach. Those who cannot teach, do. So, try not to.
I don't understand that, so I'll just let it.
Those who cannot do, teach. Meaning, he couldn't play, so he teaches.
Those who cannot do.
Teach.
Teach.
Get it?
No.
Okay. Sorry, Keith. Right over his head. No, I'm just talking. Last one. Last one before
bring
a little
bring back Robert
surprise.
From Alabama.
Oh, gosh. Brett Alexander says, having Winky tutor Whedon is like having Shaq tutor Dwight Howard on free throws.
That's good, too.
See,
that's
like
very
that
good.
Look at their other little thinking caps creatively on
those
today.
Those are my favorite ones.
For
just
Social
like,
Spotlight. Just the
those
quick,
are my favorite
the zingers,
ones.
Right? Well, like I said, Peyton and Morgan, you know, TV going on. So
this
they had
will
a little,
be good.
They had
I got to put
little,
my glasses on for this.
Message, I guess. Because it's quick, so are you ready?
Yes, I'm
let's,
ready.
Let's take a look.
I love you, Cleveland. I love you, Bruce.
Aww, love you too, girls.
So cute.
Aren't they adorable?
It was so funny. They were sitting here and they were so excited because I was like, okay, we're going to say this, then we're going to do this. They were all ready to go.
Hey.
They had their microphones on.
They're better on the air than he is. than Daddy.
Well, they were trying to like interview each other too. It was really cute. They're like,
right.
What am I? Do you smell like flowers? That was just funny. So hey, it was so nice.
I got a meeting with the new bosses coming up. I'm going to suggest that they take over.
I like it. Well, it was fun on Social Spotlight today. The girls were a joy. I hope that they're watching right now. TV debuts, like we said. We'll put your demo tape out there. And we will, what? Oh, tomorrow is Whatever Wednesday.
Whatever.
I love it.
Wednesday.
So maybe get your good questions in for Bruce. Let's put them on the spot. You can go to my Facebook page or All Bets Are Off and on Twitter at ABAOSTO and STO Ashley. And a special little close for you coming out of here.
Follow us on Facebook and Twitter.